أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألف لام را، تلك آيات الكتاب المبين. إنا أنزلناه قرآنا عربيا لعلكم تعقلون. نحن نقص عليك أحسن القصص بما أوحينا إليك هذا القرآن وإن كنت من قبله لمن الغافلين. إذ قال يوسف لأبيه يا أبت إني رأيت أحد عشر كوكبا والشمس والقمر رأيتهم لي ساجدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. فالحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Today is the first day that I'm starting, inshallah, a long series on a study of Surah Yusuf. And I thought the coming month of Ramadan is a really good time to go over one of the most unique surahs of the Quran. And I decided to start this series not from the first of Ramadan, but before then, because there are lots of things to discuss in its introduction. There's quite a few things I think that are important to take note of and to have ourselves calibrated mentally, spiritually, in the right direction so we can take full advantage of what Allah has given us, this gift that Allah has given us in this surah. The first thing to note, of course, is that this was a unique gift given to the Prophet himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anybody who's ever studied this surah knows one of the most famous things to know about this surah is that it was given to the Prophet ﷺ in the year of grief, Aam al-Huzn. So his wife Khadija has passed, the support of his uncle is gone, things in Mecca have gotten way worse than they ever were before. I mean, there was already opposition, but at least there was some level of family support, but all of that has but evaporated, so it's completely gone. And he's going through extreme turmoil in this state, not only in his personal life at the loss of loved ones, but now people have sprung new confidence in being more aggressive towards him. So things have gotten a lot worse for him internally, personally, emotionally, and also from the outside. So from both fronts, he's going through a lot, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in that context, Allah gave him this surah. A lot of scholars, when they hear the name or when they process the name Yusuf, which is of course the most, you know, pretty much the only subject talked about in the surah, with the exception of a few ayat in the beginning and a few ayat at the end, pretty much the entire surah is about Yusuf alayhi salam. They attribute the word Yusuf to the word asaf. And the word asaf in Arabic means sadness or sorrow. So they say that his name has to do with sorrow, and then they kind of extrapolate from that so much of his life was spent in sorrow because he was taken away from his family. He spent so many years of his life in prison. And then even when he had a reunion with his family, they said ill things about him to his face. So there's lots and lots of sorrow in his life. And that's why his name is Yusuf. And this was the year of sorrow for the Prophet ﷺ. So that's why he was given this name. This is why this surah is important for the Prophet ﷺ. I would argue that the word Yusuf also, you have to look at its Hebrew meaning because it's actually not an Arabic word. He's one of the prophets of the Israelites. That's very, very clear. In fact, he even mentions his lineage in the surah itself. And clearly his name is actually Hebrew. And from the Hebrew origins, it means something else. But we'll talk about that a little bit later. I will say, though, that I don't dismiss that the Arabic origin should be, or the Arabic connection should be considered, because Allah does bring names from other languages into the Arabic, right? So that there's an element of that meaning there. But to say that's the only meaning there, that's where I don't find myself in agreement. So where do I want to begin with this surah, or introducing you guys to this surah? I think the first place to begin is Ibrahim alayhi salam. You see, there are some prophets in the Quran, in the study of the Quran, that are pivotal. They're absolutely fundamental prophets. You have to know about them. You have to learn about them. And they are talked about more often than anyone else. And the way they are talked about clearly illustrates that their stories and their legacy and their connections to each other are just of the highest importance. I won't give you a lecture about who those prophets are, but of them, there are two that I want to mention for now. And one of them is Ibrahim alayhi salam, and the other one is Musa alayhi salam. Musa alayhi salam, I've talked about many times before. He's the most talked about prophet in the Quran, so that's obvious. With Ibrahim alayhi salam, it's important to note that Allah calls him, calls Islam itself the religion of our father Ibrahim, or Abraham, as Ibrahim is another reading of the same word in the Quran too, right? So when, you know, your Western friends may say Abraham, that's actually not entirely an incorrect pronunciation of the name. It's part of the original pronunciations of the name. But anyway, we are the religion of Ibrahim. That's one of our names. And our Prophet ﷺ was told to cleanse the house built by Ibrahim ﷺ. You can even argue that his seerah, his 23 years, were actually fulfilling the legacy that was started by his father, the dream of his father that people will come to this house from all corners of the world, was fulfilled by the legacy of our Prophet ﷺ, by the coming of the Quran. So you could see how Ibrahim alayhi salam is of fundamental importance, and understanding everything we can about Ibrahim alayhi salam is directly important for our understanding of even our own Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because that's in a sense his father, his, you know, his patriarch, and it's also important that that's his role model. Allah tells our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, "Fattabi' millata Ibrahima hanifan," follow the religion of Ibrahim exclusively, and be solely dedicated to that religion. So even our Prophet is told that, alayhi salatu wasalam. Anyhow, why am I starting with Ibrahim alayhi salam if this is Surah Yusuf? Well, Ibrahim alayhi salam, it's interesting that the Quran highlights a conversation that happened between him and Allah that's not found in the Bible. And there's a conversation that you find in the Bible that God has with him that's not found in the Quran. So the conversation that he has with Allah in the Quran is he's worried about his children, that Allah has guaranteed him that he is a leader over all of humanity. Inni ja'iluka lin-nasi imama. When he passed all of the most difficult tests, after all of them, Allah told him, I'm making you a leader over all of humanity. And his immediate concern was, wa min dhurriyati, what about my children? I'm referring to Surah Al-Baqarah. What about my offspring and their kids and their kids and their kids? So he wasn't just worried that Allah has graduated me, are my kids going to be okay? And Allah said to him, لَا يَنَالُ عَهْدِ الظَّالِمِينَ, my guarantee doesn't cover wrongdoers. I'm making you a promise that I'll give you leadership, but leadership is not guaranteed for those who do wrong. So he immediately knew that among his children there will be wrongdoers. Right? That part we already knew. This is not mentioned in the Bible. This is not talked about in the scriptures before, or if it was, it's lost. What we have now is a concern of Ibrahim alayhi salam that some of his children will lose their way, right? And this conversation happened after he built the Kaaba along with his son Ismail. And in that conversation, he asked for a prophet, meaning from Ibrahim through Ismail, Ya Allah, at least give my son Ismail among his offsprings, give them a messenger who will recite your revelations to you, right? And so for Ismail alayhi salam, many, many, many generations later, thousands of years later, you get Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, there's another conversation. There's a separate conversation. And that conversation is about the child that he's going to have in a very old age. His name is Ishaq. And that name, so he's younger than Ismail alayhi salam. And Ishaq has a son named Yaqub, and Yaqub is going to have 12 sons. They're called the 12 sons of Yaqub. Yaqub has another nickname, Israel, so they're also called the 12 sons of Israel. So let me walk you through that again. Abraham has two famous sons. You've got Ishmael and Isaac, Ismail and Ishaq, right? From Ismail, all of the generations later, eventually you get Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's the prophet you get. From the children of Ismail, through coming back to Ibrahim alayhi salam. On the other side, Ibrahim alayhi salam has a son named Ishaq in very old age, Isaac. Ishaq has a son named Yaqub. He has other sons too, but he has a son named Yaqub. The Quran doesn't talk about his other sons. The Bible does. Okay, but we won't get into that. Anyway, so he has a son named Jacob or Yaqub. Yaqub then has 12 sons. One of them is Yusuf. So the thing to note now is, for those of you who didn't know, Yusuf is the grandson of Ibrahim. A great-grandson of Ibrahim. So his father is Yaqub, who's a prophet. His grandfather is Ishaq, who's also a prophet. And his great-grandfather is Ibrahim alayhi salam. So he's third generation now, you know, fourth generation prophecy. One after the other, after the other, after the other. This is the person that we're talking about now. So he's a few generations separated from Ibrahim alayhi salam. But he's still carrying the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam. How do we know that? Actually, later on, at one point, Yusuf alayhi salam is going to be in jail. And when he's in jail, he's talking to a couple of inmates. And when he's talking to them, he brings up that he belongs to the religion of his fathers. And the first father he mentions is Ibrahim alayhi salam. So he sees himself connected to that legacy, right? Now, this is important because just like he's a few generations disconnected, but still connected to who? Ibrahim alayhi salam. Our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is attributing his religion to his father, Ibrahim alayhi salam. Right? Millata abikum Ibrahim. The religion of your father, Ibrahim. So just like he sees Ibrahim alayhi salam as his father figure, our religion and our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sees Ibrahim alayhi salam as a father figure. Now, here's where the important stuff begins. In the Bible, I won't go into the entire conversation because that'll come up as we discuss the ayat in detail, the comparative analysis from the Bible. But what I will mention to you for now is God promises Abraham that his children will be as numerous as the stars, right? And in the biblical account, he's been promised a promised land. So the Israelites believe that they were promised a land through a conversation that happened between God and Abraham. That's why they were promised a land. Now the Quran paints a very different picture. The Quran doesn't talk about the promise of any land. The Quran talks about the promise of being good so long as, or being given leadership so long as they don't do wrong. Right? There's no guarantee of land. And the Quran paints a very different picture of land. Ibrahim alayhi salam himself wandering all over, never in one place. And on top of all of that, Allah says in the Quran, "Inna ardi wasi'atun fa'iyaya fa'budun." My land is vast. Worship only me. So the land isn't anybody's. It belongs to Allah. And eventually when Ibrahim alayhi salam does want his family, his children to settle, he's not interested in them having a homeland. He's interested in them coming to Allah's house. So instead of them having a home, he's more interested in them coming to Allah's house. So it's a big contrast between the biblical picture that's being painted for the promise of Ibrahim alayhi salam and the Quran's picture that's being painted. But this is important because the religious identity of the Jewish people and the religious identity of the Christian people also is very fundamentally tied to the conversation, especially the Jewish people, with Ibrahim alayhi salam. To this day, politics is affected because of a claim to land. And they, from a religious point of view, they believe that land was promised to them through Ibrahim alayhi salam. Right? So that's part of this narrative. Now, the thing is, in the Quran, now coming back to that, why is Yusuf alayhi salam so important? Because Allah gave the Israelites more prophets than any other people. Quran describes that as فَضَّلْنَاكُمْ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ فَضَّلْتُكُمْ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ I gave you preference over all other nations and all other people of the world. I gave you more miracles, I gave you more blessings, I gave you more prophets than anybody else. Our prophet would tell us about them, about the Israelites. When I say Israelites, what do I mean? The sons of which prophet? Yaqub. The sons of Yaqub and their children and their children and their children, right? Allah says about them, these, you know, that He gave them more blessings than any other. Our Prophet tells us, كُلَّمَا هَلَكَ نَبِيٌّ خَلَفَ نَبِيٌّ Every time one of their prophets would die, another would take his place. Another would take his place. So literally, they had every generation of prophets, sometimes multiple prophets in one generation. But the legacy of the Israelite prophets, and by the way, the majority of the prophets talked about in the Quran, the majority of the prophets talked about in the Quran are Israelite prophets. This is also important to know. They're from the Isaac line. Ishaq alayhi salam is mentioned. Yaqub alayhi salam is mentioned. Yusuf alayhi salam is mentioned. Then after that, you've got the Israelite prophets like Zakariya alayhi salam, Yahya alayhi salam. You've got, you know, Dawud alayhi salam, Sulaiman alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salam, I already mentioned several times, Harun alayhi salam. You, prophet after prophet after prophet, if they belong, if you look at who belongs to one family more than any other, that would be the Israelite prophets. They are a big deal in the Quran too. They're a big deal in the Quran too. But them turning into a nation and prospering as a people and having as many children as the stars, as the imagery is in the Bible, all of that actually starts with Yusuf alayhi salam. And you know, the Old Testament, the final portion of the Old Testament, you know, in the book of Genesis, the last story is actually that of Joseph. It's this story. And then from there on in the next book, subsequent books, it's basically predominated by the story of Musa alayhi salam. Why? Because the Musa story, the Moses story, could not exist without the Yusuf story. It couldn't exist. So now think about that, not from a Jewish and Christian point of view, think about that from a Muslim point of view. How much of the Quran is taken up by Israelite prophets? How much of the Quran is taken up by the account, especially of Musa alayhi salam and Harun alayhi salam versus the Pharaoh? How much of it? And none of that guidance that we have until Judgment Day, is that history doesn't play out until the events happen that happened in the life of Yusuf alayhi salam. So he's of pivotal importance from a historical point of view. And of course, the people before us understood that. The people of Scripture, they look at this as such an important, you know, part of their legacy and their history, because the, you know, Yusuf alayhi salam, it's because of him that his family left Canaan, Canaan, and they left from there and came all the way to Egypt, right? So they ended up in Misr. And in Egypt, they settled, they were given good housing, they were given good economic status because Yusuf alayhi salam saved the Egyptian people because of his interpretation of a dream. All of that's coming later on. Now the Israelites are settled. Now they start becoming a prosperous people. And they start multiplying, and there's many of them, until eventually, a couple of generations later, the Egyptian powers start seeing them as a foreign threat. There's too many foreigners here, we got to do something about them. And over time, they're turned into slaves. And that's when the story of Musa alayhi salam takes place. Right? So you've got this chronology that's starting. You can't understand Musa alayhi salam without understanding Yusuf alayhi salam from a history point of view. So Allah has given our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam a profound historical gift in giving him the story of Yusuf alayhi salam and setting the record straight. But in this part of this introduction, what I wanted to say, few other pointers. One of them is that what Allah has given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran is so different about Yusuf, is so different from what you find with the previous people in the Bible with Joseph. It's so different. And inshallah, point by point, as we go through the story, I'll try to illustrate to you how it's different. But the most important difference is how the story is being told. Not just what's being said, how it's being said. Because to Allah, in this surah, you'll find this is an incredibly intimate, personal, emotional surah. Where every single event that is so close to the heart is mentioned, and so much you and I can learn from our personal lives is, like, you know, injected into virtually every ayah of this surah. So while the people before us looked at this surah for its historical importance and the birth of a nation, and its, you know, its even political importance and the importance of it from a civilization point of view, the Quran acknowledges that in the background passively, but the Quran is far more concerned with the personal story of Yusuf alayhi salam, with the personal story of his brothers, with the personal grief and pain of Yaqub alayhi salam. So it's an extremely personalized surah of the Quran, you know, and it's a very different take on history. If you study history, right, history is almost non-emotional. History is just hard and dry facts. It doesn't connect, it doesn't bring you to tears. But this is a story that demands that you connect to it deeply. As a matter of fact, by the end of this story, Allah says that in the way that Allah tells their stories, there's ibrah. Ibrah in Arabic, they translate that in English translation, they say it's a lesson. لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قِصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ. Right? In their stories, there's ibrah. Ibrah means a lesson. But abara in Arabic actually means to cross over water. So when you go from one end of the river to the other, crossing over, that's ibrah, which is a good play on, interesting play on words, because they crossed over eventually, right? So that's an interesting play on words. But the other thing also is, ibrah is used when you hear a story or you hear something that touches you so much that the tear crosses over and comes from the inside of your eye and it comes out. So he says, in their stories, especially in this one, there are things that will move you to tears. That's what Allah himself says. So this is his way of telling the story. This is his way of narrating that account. Now, before I wrap up this first session of the introduction, it's going to take me a couple of days to finish this introduction, but I wanted to share a couple of really quick things. I've talked about the connection to Ibrahim alayhi salam a little bit. I've talked to you about the Arabic origins of the name. Maybe we'll go into the Hebrew origins of the name, maybe inshallah in the subsequent session. I also want to tell you something that has been tried by desperate theologians from a Christian point of view to retell or reinterpret the story of Yusuf. The Jews, we understand why it's important for those people, the Israelites, why Yusuf alayhi salam is important. That's clear. I mean, literally, he's the son of Israel, right? And they're called the sons of Israel. So he's the original son of Israel. So that's why that's important. From a Christian point of view, Paul presented the idea that Jesus didn't come to the Israelites, that Jesus came for all of humanity, that Jesus is a salvation for all human beings, all people, all nations. And this became a problem because the Bible clearly says, I have come for the lost sheep of the sons of Israel. Jesus says it clearly and openly, I came for the Israelites. And in the Quran, he doesn't say people. He says, Ya Bani Israel, sons of Israel, I'm a messenger of Allah to you. So Quran makes it clear and biblical evidence makes it clear that Jesus came specifically for the Israelites, like all of the other Israelite prophets. In fact, he's the last of them to come specifically to the Israelites. That's the key. Now, and actually this is why they had a problem with Rasulullah, because he didn't come to the Israelites. So the Jews of Medina, the Israelites of Medina, had a problem with Muhammad because, no, well, we don't accept prophets unless they come specifically to us. No, this time he was sent to all of humanity. But the Christians have a completely different take. The Christians wanted to believe in a doctrine that internationalizes Christianity. We don't want it to be for the Israelites. We want it to be for all of humanity. And Paul presents this notion, right, that it's for all of, we have to save all of humanity with the blood of Christ and all of it, right? Now, in order to do that, you have to go back to the prophets' stories and you have to find some way of justifying that, you know, prophets, even Israelite prophets, can be international. So, therefore, Isa alayhi salam was an international prophet. So, the first case study would be this one. Why? Because Yusuf alayhi salam moved from Canaan, from his family, and he came and he helped with his interpretation of the dream. He helped the Egyptian people. Right, so clearly he wasn't limited to the Israelites. He helped the Egyptian people. Therefore, we gotcha. We got. I mean, this is such a stretch to, like, it doesn't even go into the spirit of the story. Is he even a messenger to the Israelites? Is he preaching to them? Or, you know, or what does his legacy stand for? All of that's pushed aside just to pull something as an evidence to justify something completely unrelated. Right? So these desperate kinds of attempts, I point that out not to criticize the Christian attempt, but actually to point that out a certain kind of mentality. Revelation speaks for itself. When you try to dig into revelation to justify a conclusion you've already made, there's a big problem. Because then your conclusion is higher and revelation is lower. And you need to use revelation to only strengthen your point. Your conclusions should always come second. Your humility to revelation should come first. And you come to revelation without any conclusions. And you let Allah Himself give you conclusions. You don't come to it with conclusions to prove your point. Or I already have my point, now I'm going to dig around in the Quran to find how I can prove it. That means your mind, your opinion, your thesis, your theory is above the word of Allah. And the word of Allah is just some evidence you can use to furnish as, you know, a reference. It's just a reference, that's all it is. How is that regard for the word of Allah? How is that humility for the word of God? How is that humility? So this is something I don't just say this as Christians. Some Christians have done this. I say that Muslims do this. I say that Jews do this. I say that anybody who takes the wrong approach towards revelation will fall into this trap. And that's something to be warned about as we introduce ourselves to the surah. The last thing I'll share with you, and that's where the fun begins, inshallah, tomorrow, is something that happened with me almost a decade ago. I was studying, you know, different stories of the Quran, and particularly I have a fascination with Musa alayhi salam, and I was studying Surah Al-Qasas. Surah Al-Qasas is surah number 28. It tells the early life of Musa, when he was a baby, basket, that part of the story, right? And later on, it mentions some of the comments of the Pharaoh when he was introduced to the message of Islam. So I want you to pay attention to this. It's all coming back to Yusuf, okay? So the Pharaoh says something that hit me. He says, "Ma hadha illa sihru muftara." This is the Pharaoh talking. Once he's heard the message of Musa. Okay, so he says, "Ma hadha illa sihru muftara." This is nothing but magic that's been made up. This is just creative magic. "Wa ma sami'na bi hadha fi aba'ina al-awwalin." This is the part. He says, we've never heard of anything like this since our earliest ancestors. We never heard of anything like a prophet, or one God, or revelation, or heaven and hell. What is this stuff? We've never, not us, not our ancestors, have ever heard anything like this. Okay? So the first part, he just calls it magic that's creative. But the second part, your attention needs to be on the second part. He says, we've never heard of this. The Pharaoh says, we've never heard of this. Now, when he said that, I was kind of struck, because I was already, my mind was already traveling in a direction where I thought there has to be a connection between Yusuf alayhi salam and Musa alayhi salam. Now I know the historical connection. They're both Israelite prophets. They have something in common. They were both in Egypt, right? They're both in Egypt. But there was something more in common between them. Here we are studying Surat Yusuf. Surat Yusuf's, one of its pivotal ayat in the beginning is, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ. We are telling you the best, we have the best way of telling qasas, the narrative. The narrative, qasas. And surah number 28, which is not about Yusuf, it's about Musa, is called Al-Qasas. So this one in the beginning uses the term qasas, and that surah itself is called qasas. And I said, there has to be a Quran connection between these two. But I didn't think much of it at the time. Then what really hit me, it's about a decade ago, is when I heard Pharaoh say, and I never thought about it before, the Pharaoh says, I've never heard of anything like this. We've never heard of anything of this since our early ancestors. But the question is, did they? Because Yusuf was in Egypt, right? And he wasn't just any person who people never listened to. He in fact saved the kingdom of Egypt. So he's a pretty important historical figure. How, and Yusuf alayhi salam, there's no way he was silent about what he believes. He wasn't even silent in prison. How is he going to be silent when he's minister of finance or the vice president of the country? He's going to be silent about what he believes in? And then after he's publicly had a reunion with his family, which is going to happen in this surah, when he has a reunion with his family is there in the parliament. Because وَرَفَعَ أَبَوَيْهِ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ, he put his parents on the throne. He raised, where's the throne? Throne's not in his house. Where is it? It's in the government building. So they're discussing Allah's grand plan of reuniting the family and thanking Allah and my dream came true and the prophecy. They're discussing all of that inside an Egyptian palace. Can you imagine? And any conversations that publicly happen inside a government building, aren't they part of public record? Don't they become part of history? This is not some private secret conversation. And putting somebody on the official government chair, the throne, is that a small thing? That's a pretty big thing. But how come there doesn't seem to be, how come the Pharaoh can say with such confidence, we've never heard of anything like this? So my mind was kind of wondering for what the answer could be until I reached surah number 40. Surah number 40 is called Surah Ghafir. It's also called Suratul Mu'min, the surah of the believer. It's called the surah of the believer because that surah contains a very long speech given by a very special man. This man is not a prophet. This man is believed to be a good friend of Musa. He was a police officer. Early on in Musa's life, when he punched someone and accidentally killed him, that police officer secretly had already become Muslim, and he was part of a meeting in which he found out that the police is trying to kill Musa alayhi salam without a trial. As soon as they find him, they'll kill him. But they don't know that he's Muslim, that he believes in the God of Musa, and they don't know that he's friends with Musa. So he secretly goes to Musa, tells him, you need to get out of here, inni laka minan nasihin. By the way, all of this is Surah Al-Qasas, Surah number 28. He tells him to get out of here. He was the one that saved Musa alayhi salam's life in helping him escape Egypt, telling him, don't come back, don't turn yourself in, because the cops won't arrest you, they're going to kill you. Fine. In surah number 40, the Pharaoh says, he's had enough, this is many years later, Musa's back, the signs have taken place and all of it. The Pharaoh says, I've had enough of Musa. I'm ready to kill him. Even though he's family, I love him. I'm ready to kill him now. And that friend of Yusuf, he must have been promoted by now, so he must be a police chief or a commissioner or a general, one of his generals. So he's in the military meeting where they're discussing the execution of Musa now with Pharaoh in the court. He couldn't take it anymore. He was secretly hiding his faith. But he opened up. He opened up. And he said, وَلَقَدْ جَ... So he starts talking to them about how can you hate someone who calls to one God? What are you doing? We're asking for our own destruction. And I'm inviting you guys to understand this surah. Just do a cursory reading of Surah 40 and his monologue. Imagine him standing in the court of the pharaohs, going at it, giving this speech. And this speech is so powerful, it became part of the Quran. Can you imagine? Rarely do you find this length of a speech from a single prophet that you find from this man in the Quran. It's a special place. But one of the things he said, man, I kid you not, if I didn't fall off my chair, I purposely fell off my chair. وَلَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ يُوسُفُ مِنْ قَبْلُ Yusuf had definitely come to all of you before, remember? He's telling the Egyptian parliament who had come to you before? Yusuf. So he's telling, can he's educated, trained in Egypt by them. And he went to their schools, their military schools. He took their history classes. And in their history classes, what did they learn about? A man named Yusuf. And he's referring to what they all already know. And telling them, by the way, why are you acting like you don't know anything that Musa is talking about? This sounds exactly like who? Yusuf. This sounds exactly like him. You know all of this already. What do you mean you've never heard of it? He calls them out. He calls them out. And he even says, حَتَّى إِذَا هَلَكَ until the time when Yusuf died, قُلْتُمْ لَيَبْعَثَ اللَّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ رَسُولًا You people had the audacity to say, Allah will never send a messenger after this. Allah will never send a messenger after this. This is what y'all said when Yusuf died. It's on record. It's an Egyptian record. He's citing the Egyptian. He's not citing the Bible. He's not citing some scripture. He's citing Egyptian history. And telling it to Egyptian politicians and military commanders. And telling him, you were the people who said, God will never send another messenger. I'm adding my personal interpretation here. What I think, I've shared it with a couple of scholars. And they're inclined towards this, but they're not fully convinced. I'm pretty convinced. Here's what I believe. What I believe is Yusuf alayhi salam, before he died, let them know that after me, a messenger will come to you. I'm telling you, Allah sent me to save you, Egypt. But if you don't accept this message, just like Allah sent me to save you from turmoil, it may be that Allah will send a messenger. And if you don't listen to him, what happens to every other nation will happen to you when you reject a messenger, you will be destroyed. And you were so confident when he died because you appreciated his political and economic service, but you didn't appreciate his religion too much. And you said, yeah, he talked about a messenger will come. Ain't no messenger coming. And now you've got this general in parliament saying, remember when you said there's no other messenger coming? And here we have who? Musa right here. In other words, Musa alayhi salam's legacy is so intimately tied to Yusuf alayhi salam that even the worst of the disbelievers, the pharaohs, they recognized it. They recognized it. It's a very powerful connection. And if Musa alayhi salam is the most talked about prophet in the Quran, messenger in the Quran, then there's no way that we can underestimate the value of the life and the legacy of Yusuf alayhi salam, because they're intimately tied to each other. So this is what led me to explore the connection. This was the starting point, this discovery, was the starting point of me trying to explore the connection between Yusuf alayhi salam and Musa alayhi salam. Beyond the obvious, beyond the fact that they were just both in Egypt, beyond the fact that they were both, you know, messengers of Israel, you know, beyond that there's a recollection of the two with each other. What else connects these two together, especially from a Quran point of view? So when I started exploring this, I found more things than I ever imagined. I didn't find them in a tafsir book or in a literary analysis book. These are sort of my own discoveries. I wrote about them on Facebook, I think, a long time ago. But before we get started on the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, I will walk you through those parallels, because this is the Quran's way of telling stories, to make those connections. Right, so you're never reading or learning something in isolation. You're learning it in connection to something. You're learning it in connection to something. So inshallah ta'ala, we'll cover some of that. And then after that, we'll talk a little bit more about sabab nuzul. And then we'll get into the ayat themselves. Just to give you guys my plan for Ramadan, my sessions will be probably around 30 minutes. The intro sessions may be a little longer, because I want to get some longer stuff out of the way. But my regular sessions will be at 30, 35 minutes at the most. They'll be around, our Maghrib here is 8 o'clock Central Time, so they'll be around 8:30 p.m. my time, but it shifts by a minute or two, so we're starting at 8:30 Central, and it'll move from there, inshallah. I'll try to keep up with all 30 days to do these sessions, and I'm starting tonight. So this was my first session, and from now until the end of Ramadan, inshallah, I'm going to try to do as much as we can from the surah. I am not promising you that we're going to finish the surah. All I am saying is we're going to do what we can. I don't like to rush through a study of a surah or the teaching of a surah. So if it takes us 2 years to go through Surah Yusuf, I'm okay with that. But at least we're getting a kickstart in the month of Ramadan, inshallah ta'ala. So my recommendation to all of you is to, if you'd like to, you know, keep up with it, I've asked my colleague, Sheikh Suhaib Saeed, to actually recite a couple of ayat of the surah every day and put it up on his Facebook page, and probably have him put it on Bayina's YouTube page too. So if you guys want to like learn to memorize the surah, even recite it little by little, get on that. So that, okay, after 30 days, you came out with some more Quran than you used to have before, right? That's what I'd like you to have. I'd like you to have, by the time Ramadan ends, okay, you don't know everything about the Quran, but you know some things more, and you have a deeper connection with some part of it that you didn't have before, and you have the blessing of having memorized it, so you can pray with it. You can cry with it. Cry with it to Allah. You know, cry with it in your empty moments. That's the most valuable gift that Allah can give us, is tears from our eyes when we recite His words. May Allah Azza wa Jalla bless all of us with genuine tears and genuine tawbah and accepted worship in this coming month of Ramadan. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.